Good morning, everybody. My name is Moses. We'll be operating again as usual. We're a little bit delayed this morning because of the rain. It's been drizzling early this morning, so now it looks like it's going down a bit. So we'll start from now on. Beautiful morning.
The school has three sets of tracks here. Not more than one or two.
Yeah, I've got some male lion tracks here. Very fresh lion tracks. We just want to see where they went to from the road. It looks like they were all lying down, yeah?
Well, as you could see, the picture from the game drive vehicle just froze just now. It might just be the inverter acting up again. Moses and Rexon are rebooting, and we should be back with them pretty soon.
Yeah, welcome everybody. We're still trying to find out what happened to these male lion tracks, but it looks like they all went that way, so we're gonna follow up from here. Okay. Still heading south. Could be Manyeletu boys or Mapoko, so we'll see if we find them. Yeah, we got them there in front there, they're all standing. Nice tracking again. Looks like Mapoko of males. One calling there in the distance. There's two of them lying down and one, they're all moving now. There are three of them on focus. motorcycle driving here. There's four of them.
Four?
Yeah. Oh. Looks like they're a little bit skittish. I don't know what happened in the night. And Rendu?
Welcome back for Pocos.
We just spoken about them yesterday. Eventually they're all back to our ground again. But it looks like they're a little bit skittish. Maybe it's because of the vehicle. Most of the time when we're doing a safari, that's how we're trying to tell everybody. We must always sit together in the same level. But if you have someone like sticking up a little bit, so the animals are a little bit nervous because they're not used to that kind of individual or object sticking out. So I'm going to try maybe again to go a little bit forward and see if they will be relaxed to the vehicle. Nice, beautiful mountains.
You can show Andrew. You are this beautiful.
Andrew, do you copy? Any Juma session can copy me? We've got some impalas on the right hand side there. It looks like they've already seen these lions, so they're not worried about them. And some of them, they're approaching these lions, but as long as they can able to see them, they don't really worry about them, because these guys, it looks like they're not interested on these impalas. If they were interested, they wouldn't have been into the open area like that. Yeah, the impala snorting here on our right hand side. It looks like they're warning each other. These four males here, they're from the coalition of six. There's two male lions missing here, they're not here. But most of the time they are gathering but sometimes because they have extended their territories, so they sometimes decided to like split in half. Maybe there's two together, or maybe the other two, they're somewhere else with the females. We have like several females around in the area. And also there was a question, how do we recognize them, like the females? The question, it was coming, it was according to the Kuhuma females, how do we recognize them individually? So in these male lions here, some are, they've got a, like a very dark manes, and some of them, they've got like the manes been teared. I'm sure they probably had a fight with another male we have in the area. Like the one there, the big male sitting at the back there, that is the first dominant male. There's two dominant males in between this coalition. So the one that lying down is the first one, and the second one, it is the one with the a cat tail at the tip. So most of the time, those are the two that are competing when it comes to the mating time. When they are mating with females, those two males, they are the ones that we usually see them with females. So that's how we pick them up as a dominant male. This is the lions that we have seen them. Most of the time, they were killing some cubs around here. We used to have like different pride of lions, but most of them, they've been chased out in the territories by these male lions. The group of them is called Makoko male. So this is the male lions that we were talking about yesterday. So eventually they're all back. And because over the night, we believe that maybe those females we saw like yesterday in the afternoon, Kuhuma pride, when we got there yesterday, they were a little bit scattered all over the area. Maybe some cubs last night, they were lost somewhere there. Maybe those females, they were trying to call them. So these guys, they could maybe head them in the distance. That's why they're here. They're a little bit alert. I don't know what happened at night, but we will find out as we drive. Like the one there lying down, the dominant one, it looks like he's very aware about something in the surroundings. And also because these male lions, they don't really come that far that often. So if they decide to take a nap, knowing that there's some other male lions, say like Manyeleti boys, they can come into the area at any time. And I don't know if maybe they were calling, but when we got here, we heard one of them calling in the distance. So if they do, if maybe they heard them, they might also visit them if they're not scared of them. Because four big male lions for one big male lion, it's not that easy to take them on. I'm sure these guys, as far as I know them, this guy there was born in Malamala, I think maybe 8 to 9 years ago. They're from the pride of 14. The reason I'm saying this, because most of the guys that we live with them, they work at Malamala. So what we do, each and every time we come together and find out about lions or about any cats they have, and how many different pride of lions do they see in the month, so we all write it down. But with this guy, as I said, they was born in the group of 14. They used to have like four adults, and all of them, they were youngsters. But by that time, their mothers, they brought them down to the north, very close to Wuyatela Lodge. And they went down to Simbambele Lodge, which is not far from here. It's about maybe 4 kilometers. I have seen them there. It was 2000, the time when we had a flood here. I remember when they got here, we saw them. They spent about 4 days because of most of the rivers. They were overflowing, so they couldn't manage to return back where they belonged. And then from there, we didn't see them again. And now they are back again into our area. It looks like they like this area. And as you can see their body language, it looks like they spotted something on our right again, or they heard something. But it looks like there's another vehicle approaching to the sighting. That's why they're all up and looking and what's coming. And also the impalas, they're still browsing and grazing there very close to them. It looks like they also want to keep an eye on them because they don't need them to sneak behind them, otherwise they might get eaten. And also when it comes to the hunting, these male lions, they hunt by themselves. And as you can see, even in the distance, about 100 meters, 200 meters, you could still see them if they are sitting like that. But once they're lying flat, it's a little bit difficult to see them. But if they're sitting, because most of the people, they're tending to ask, is the male lions do hunt himself or do a hunt by themselves? They do. Especially in Sabisantia, the terrain is so thick. So I don't see any problem for them not to hunt by themselves, because they can manage to get closer to the prey. And we have seen most of the time these guys, they specialize on big games, because for them as a 4 miles or 6 miles to chase impala or stalking impalas, hunting impala, sometimes it's just a such of a waste of energy. So for them, if they try the best to get, I've seen them many times like killing buffaloes. And also in Sabisent, each and every 6 months we put Sabisent border and the parks board, Sabisent ranges, they count the animals. But what they do, they get a helicopter each and every 6 month time, so they fly up in the air and counting animals. So like each and every time they're giving us the record how many lions we have the entire Sabisent. As we know that in Sabisent and Kruger National Park, we don't have any fences, so these animals, they walk freely to Kruger National Park and back to Sabisent. We used to have a fence about 14-15 years ago, and these guys, but sometimes they do cross over into Kruger and back to our area. But even though we're always getting a record for all the animals we have, but it's a little bit difficult for impalas. Impalas, we have them like each and every corner. You can count about 25, but some, they're still born even yesterday, they was born maybe today. So that's why we call them a money bag animals, because everybody can eat them or can get them everywhere.
This time Moses, Mapoho will manage to mate, or what's going to happen with Mapoho and Kuhumas?
The previous time when these guys were here, I just heard, I wasn't there, but I heard about them. I saw them crossing over into Wuyatela property, and I've been told that they killed about 3 to 4 cubs, if I'm not mistaken. And by that time, the Kuhuma pride, there were about 16 animals individual in the group. And then these guys, they went back again, because as far as I understand, Manyeleti boys and Kuhumas, I'm sure they are from the same pride, if I'm not mistaken about that. These guys, they went back to Malamala, because Malamala also, they have like 4 or 5 different pride of lions there. So these guys, they're so interested to mate with like different females. I'm sure they're just trying to bring their own blood into the area. So what happened to Kuhuma pride? By that time, Kuhuma pride, they used to cross over into the south. When we talk about south, we talk about Malamala, one of the biggest game reserve we have here, and also Londolos. They are all down to the south, and Sabi Sabi as well, very close to Kruger National Park border. So these guys, that is the place where they were born. But because of, from sometimes when they get up to 2.5 years, 3 years old, these guys, they move out from the pride they belong, and also trying to form their own coalition or their own group. They sometimes join up with the nomadic males from some other places. If they are interested to join each other, they do so. So, but these guys, when they got here, as I said, they were chasing a Kuhuma pride, because Kuhumas, they have got a lot of herbs. And the reason they're chasing them, maybe they don't really like their blood. They actually want to bring their own gene into those females. But I suggest maybe, because it happens previous time where we saw these guys, I can maybe just explain about what happened, and then I'll come back to that question again. And it was like early in the morning, like today, beautiful morning, a cloudy day, drizzling, and these guys, by that time they were still together, like always together, wherever they go together. And they, that one there at the back, it looks like he's a little bit older than them. You can see his face, he's got the scars. He's the one who fight the most, because sometimes when he mates with some other females, some females they're not interested, they, like, force them to mate with them, and some they are interested, and also sometimes they fight amongst each other when it comes to the feeding time. And these guys, they were down to the south, and they were all lying down. It was early in the morning, about 4:30 in the morning, and because that is the time when we get ready, you have to go up about 4 o'clock, so you prepare vehicles, you prepare everything for safari. We heard them calling, they were not far, and that previous night we had a sandy patch pride that we were talking about yesterday. There was two females. Sorry, it's not a sandy patch, it's the other pride called Salali pride. There were three of them, but two sub-adults and a wild old female. So those two females there, they had about six cubs, and they used to have one big male, a lion, with them. So he was the father of those six cubs. So that morning, what happened to them, that last night, though, they made a kill. They killed a zebra. Most of the time, the way they killed zebras, they chased them and catched them. But what happened there, because the zebras, they were very close to the fence line, the fence we have in Sabisens to protect our animals to go out to the villages. So what happened there is they chased that zebra, and the zebra ran into the fence and bounced back and caught it there next to the road. They were all feeding, so that they decided to, because one of the females, she were not there, she moved off that night, because she had her own two sub-adults. So the other two females, they have about six cubs. They were about 9 to 10 months old. So what they did, they decided to invite the mother, the older female with their own two cubs, but they were from the same tribe. So she brought her own two cubs, the sub-adults. So they were all feeding together. One of the big males that he used to hang around with them, he used to be the father of the cubs. He was like patrolling his territory or his boundaries. You know, sometimes the way they mark their territories, they defecate and send marking, and also calling like a roaring. So that actually, it tells the other lions if they are in the area. So instead of coming in, they will know that, or they will notify that by the call, this place has been taken by someone else. So instead of going in without a permission, so they did so. So these guys, because they were always looking for those prides, so they heard them that day calling in that direction, so they were starting to chase them. They ran from where they are, from where they were, and when they got there, not far from where those females made the kill, there was another two big males. They came from the south as well. But the other two males, they got there because they were not very far. They got there before these guys got there. And those two big male lions, we used to call them roller coasters. And they was about maybe 10 years old, same size as this one. They were much lighter in color, like gray in color, but they had a very dark mane as well. So when they got there, they chased two young cubs. Those, they were belongs to Salali, the old female. they were sub adults. So they chased them from the kill, because most of the time these guys, they're not interested about food, they're more interested to the females and mating or chasing them around out the territory. Before these guys got there, the other two male lions, they managed to caught one of the Lali Prad sub adults. There was two young males together, and they managed to caught one. They killed him and they lifted him into the bushes. And these guys, when they got there, they chased the other two male lions. They ran from the kill. And then after that, they went back again, because the Salali Prad, they ran from the kill. They were not far. One of the biggest male that he used to spend time with, Salali Prad, he tried to defend the cubs and tried to defend the other three females, but he couldn't. Because of these guys, when they got the six males, they brought him down and they killed him. And it was about 5:30 in the morning. So when we got there, we saw that when it happened. We were like, everybody taking pictures. We took some pictures, we made some movies. And they killed him in front of the three vehicles, and they ate him at the same time. It took them about maybe 2 hours, and then it was only the skull left. And when we got back again, in the afternoon, the hyenas, they were there, busy chowing on the bones, and everything, it was finished.
Good. Good.
Can I join you there?
Please do. And from there, in the afternoon, we all returned back. Instead of doing some other game drives, we spent about 3 hours watching. So we left them all lying down. When we got back in the afternoon, we just only found the skull. The hyenas, they're more active at night. They were all there. And the next day, they decided to track or to start to follow up on the Salali Prad. We followed them because they were using the smell to follow them. We followed them until we get to the place where they found them. And then when we got there, they were all there in the same area. So they managed to get hold of three cubs. And those three cubs, they killed them in front of three vehicles at the same time. And they ate them again. So the one female, she was wounded badly. So from there she ran to the nearest lodge for some defense. It's an amazing story to hear about it. When she ran from the kill, she went down to the lodge called Simbombili Lodge, very close to where these guys found the cubs. But the three cubs, they managed to run from there. The other three, they've been killed by these guys and they ate them. One female, she ran down because it was about, the next day it was about maybe 7:30. So all the workers there, chefs and waitresses and waiters, they were all getting ready for breakfast in the Boma. Because sometimes when it's not that hot, we can still have breakfast outside. And that female, she just ran into the Boma. People, they were all scattered there. Some, they were all over to the roofs. Some, they ran. Some, they were kneeling down to pray and ask what if he could help. But he managed to do so. But she just ran and then get herself in a protected area. She ran underneath the tables. There were some tables and chairs. As I said, they were all getting ready for a breakfast. So somebody managed to get hold of us and ask if we can maybe come and help. So when we got there, we found that she was lying down underneath the table because she was injured badly. So she rested there for about 4 to 5 hours. Instead of having breakfast there, they found some other places to have breakfast. We didn't want to chase her away from there, because the reason she ran into the area was because she needed to have some protection from us. So about 9:30, she moved back to where incident happened. And when she got there, she just only found some bones and pieces. We followed her back to where everything it was happening. And these guys, when we got there, they were all left and they went down to drink water. And we followed them by the tracks. When we got there, we found them all lying down near the waterhole. It was so interesting to see. But some, on the other hand, it's so sad, you know, to see these big guys killing children from someone else. It's so sad. Thanks, but these guys, they don't really, as I was saying, they're from the blood of 14. So these guys, sometimes I have seen them, this is maybe for the last 3 to 4 months, it's my first time to see them four together like that. And I have seen them like two together, three together, but now I'm sure there's something going on here, as I was, because what we do, we're like always phoning each other as a guide, as a ranger. We know what's happening on other side, or because we've got like many lodges around, many guides. So we always phone each other and find out if these guys are still alive. But we heard that there was one ML being killed, so we thought it could be one of the Manyeleti boys. But the one that we saw is very injured badly. We're still looking for him. So, but these guys, I'm sure they're on the mission. That's why they all come together. They are operating, they are doing something else here. Maybe, like, as I had the question that, are these guys going to mate with Kuhuma Bride? Because that, by that time, there was one of the female Kuhum from Kuhuma Bride. She went down to the south. She managed to find these guys down to the south. So she is the one who brought these guys up to the north. They were so interested. I think she was on hit, because the females, they're also very clever. If they find out the gene they have, it's not that strong enough, so they will, she will, maybe one of the females, she will try something else. She will go some other places and try if she can manage to get some the strongest gene, because the more they have the strongest gene is the more they have like a large number of fried again. So, but I think these guys, they're on a mission, they are trying to approach, but maybe one of the day they will manage to get them, they will manage to mate with them, because this is how they operate. If they do find the pride, like the pride which is maybe nomadic, males or nomadic, just a lions that are not belonging to anywhere, they will maybe join the hands. But as far as I understand, if these guys find those Kuhuma pride, because Kuhuma pride, the cubs they have now, the sub-adult they have, are not belongs to them, and not belongs to their gene. So they could have maybe very strong gene than them. That's why every time when they find the lions, they test first. Said they're on the mission. Now they're all facing that direction. That is the direction where we saw Kuhuma females. It looks like they were on the track, because most of the time when they follow something, they use the scent. They probably lost the scent somewhere else, or maybe they didn't lose the scent. They were just trying to find them, but because of the distance and that, they decided to move back. From where we got the tracks is the place where we were following Kuhuma females. So it looks like now there's another, maybe something else, or some other brothers are calling from the distance who can't hear. You see, as you look at their body language, they're all looking at the south. The south is the place where they came from. And the sounds, that vocal, when they're roaring, that sounds can manage to run about 12 to 15 kilometers. And the reason I'm saying, but from the book you might not find it, and also because the animals that don't read and write, we write about them, we all tell the stories about them, but we have discovered that the other day. It was early in the morning, and not far from the Tela site, there was two big male lions. They were calling right at the top, Kruger National Park boundary, from Riatele, if I'm not mistaken. It would be maybe about 11 kilometers to the Kruger National Park. We were outside the park, which is from the gates another 11 kilometers. We were all coming from somewhere else early in the morning, 5 o'clock. We were all coming back to work. We heard them calling. So when we got back here, we tried to find out where they were calling from. So one of our co-workers told us he saw them early that morning when he came to the gate to pick us up. And then from there we drove. And then eventually we found them lying down on the border itself, which is, from where we heard them, it's about 23 kilometers away. Especially when it's overcasting like this today, the sound, it travels a distance. And also it depends where they're calling from. Some other places is too soft, some other places is too hard ground, and some other places we've got dongas, like the rivers, and the sound it gets back, or it gets onto the rivers, and the sound it travels along the drainage line or rivers. But sometimes when they are roaring, if they want that sounds to travel a long distance, they look for the elevated spot, like as you see them here, and start calling. Mostly they don't do it in a thick stuff because it's not going to help. The sounds it might cover by the terrain or the bushes there, so it doesn't help. As we heard them calling, it looks like the other two, they're taking a nap there. Maybe they're just trying to tell the other pride that they are in the area. They mustn't even try to come this side, or it means something else. Maybe they're calling them. I can see these two here, they're focusing on the left here. Maybe the other two, they're also responding, but because of the sound, we cannot be able to hear them. It's too far for us. But for them, because they have got a very good hearing, so they can able to hear the others in the distance. I don't know if everyone has any questions or anything to ask about them. Or is everybody getting bored?
I mean, it's interesting to see Mapoko back into the area.
Mm.
You know, as we speak, one of Mapoko is still up there. Maybe it could be an answer from Kuhuma's calling back. You never know. Well, but it was very interesting. Two of them lie down and two of them
That's how they operate sometimes. They're like alternating each other. Two, they will sleep, and two, check around for anything else, because this is the area which belongs to someone else, if I'm not mistaken. So they only come here, they only visit here, or they force themselves to be here. Maybe according to the rules or policy of the other males, they're not allowed to be here, but because they force themselves, they've got the strength to do so, so that's why they are here. but I don't think they will go anywhere else. They're gonna be around here for maybe another day or two. But because they have a lot of work to do, especially when it rains, most of the territorial animals, they don't stick around in the same position. Because as we were saying, that the way they mark or defend the territories, they all sometimes, mostly the same mark. So if it rains, because the rain, if the rain comes down, it will take all the scent away from where they were scenting or where they were marking. So it will take everything away, so they have to remark the boundaries. That's why most of the time, if you do have experience of these animals, you don't have to worry much about when it rains. After the rain, you know that they will definitely come to the area, because they have to remark the territories. That's how we found them the most, especially lions, leopards, rhinos are the ones that I know much about, because I know that they have to come back. The way they operate, the animals, they don't operate like us. If you have your own property, it depends how big is your property. You can either put the tags, you can either put the fence, but most of the people we have, they put the fences around. But because them, they don't have any fences. So that's how God made them or created them. So they put marks, they send marks. Rhinos, they have like a sort of like a toilet. It's called the rhino midden. So that's how they mark the territory.
Very interesting, Moses. yesterday I was trying to get more information about Manyeleti. Look like my Manyeleti boy, Mapoho, got one of Manyeleti. He's having a bad injury on his back leg. Look like he's broken a back leg. And there was a question from Aquila. Aquila wants to know exactly what happened with Mapoho and the other pride down southwest. We managed to get information with Mapoho. Look like he's, with Manyeleti male, broken a back leg. Chances of him to survive, according to Charles, is very, very slim. He might die. The last time we saw him, he was at lion clearing. He was lying down there by Green Pan. So you might find that this male is also tracking behind those two male, wants to kill them. The reason why they're calling now and then, maybe.
Yeah. Also, one day I saw him, the first day they came back from the south. He was limping quite badly, and the other two male lions, they had to leave him by himself somewhere in the thicket, because he was very injured. He was limping and skinny. I think it takes him about maybe 2 to 3 days without eating. So maybe he's still alive. We will check him.
I had someone in where already.
We're gonna try to relocate on Kurula and see if they're still in the area, but we believe that they will be all safe. And as we're all hearing these lions like keep on calling every now and then, so the other predators, I'm sure they will make sure that wherever they are, they will be safe. And leopards with the cubs, I'm sure she will make a plan that she will take them up in the trees. But most of the time, I know that lions and the leopards, they have that big competition food they have or territories they have, but I think she will be safe, because wherever she goes, she knows, like as we were talking about the scent, if the leopard scent mark, the other animals, they can manage to recognize that scent that is belongs to the leopard. Yes, they are, but I think wherever she walks, she will always pick up the scent from different animals, different lions. So she will keep herself in a distance with the cubs. We're not quite sure where they are at the moment, but I'm sure they will be safe. But from here, we will try our best to see if we can relocate on them again.
Scary looking, this one.
And the big male here on our left hand side, most of the people, they tend to ask you when we tell them that we don't shun any herbivores, especially when we're doing the afternoon game drive. If you look at that male lion there on the left, it's got two eyes, and around its eyes it's got like a white color around the eyes. So that white color actually helps any cats at night when they're doing their hunt. You know, sometimes it's fully moon, it's a moon, so that it helps them to reflect the moon light. And also because sometimes we use a big spotlight or torch, which is about 4,000 watts. It's burning quite hot. So you can able to see an animal about 200 to 300 meters or 400 meters. So if you get close to the cats, we try our best to get very close to them, especially mapohos and the other prize of lions we have here. We can get very close to them, about a meter or 2 meters off the vehicle. So we do shun all the cats, but not on their faces. So we try to put the spotlight down a bit so we don't blind them, because most of the herbivores, they more active during the day, so they do really need light during the day, because obviously it's already light on. But at night time, because it's so dark, they don't really need a light, because they're not more active at night, so they tend to spend time or lying down or resting underneath the trees. And also to keep an eye for the predators, and knowing that if they don't, they might end up killed. So the herbivores, most of them, they don't have that white color, so they observe too much light during the day. We only shun the cats, so it's what it helps them to reflect the moonlight. So we don't bother them when we shun them, or unless if the cats are still new in the area, because if you go down to Kruger National Park itself, it's about 2.2 million hectares. Some other places they're not allowed to do any bundi bashing, like driving into the bush, like what we do in service. And so in Sabisand, we're so fortunate because we drive wherever we want. Also, depending into the terrain, if it's too thick, we might not take you there. But if it's not, we will take you there. So we do get close to them. In Kruger National Park, some other places, animals, they don't see vehicles maybe for a month or 2 months. So they're not used to the vehicles. They're not used to see people walking. So that's how, when we get problems, if the animals come from Kruger National Park into Sabisand, they're a little bit nervous about the vehicles, they're a little bit sketchish, but we try our best to get them to used to the vehicles. Like as you see, mapohos, they're so habituated to the vehicle, so they don't see any problem. Or unless if you're standing up, because they're not used to that kind of thing. If they see anything like up in the vehicle, they don't really like it. Sometimes they run away, sometimes they might growl at you. So we're trying our best not to break the rules. Everybody must be stay seated and keep quiet. If anyone have a question, they can always ask, but you're gonna have to keep the voices down, because the animals, they does the same thing. Sometimes if you irritated by something, you don't wanna sit with other people, you don't wanna do something else, you just wanna keep quiet and spend time by yourself. So it does the same thing to an animal. They also think like what you're thinking. That's why we have them here.
Moses, I hope these four bochos, I can say they're more interested with kuhumas. As soon they get information, they might get up and move in the direction of kuhumas. You can see when we track them, the tracks were going in south, now they're heading back west, and this is the right direction of mapoho, of kuhumas, because they headed west of Sandipage.
Yeah, these animals, they've got a very good sense of smell. They can able to smell any or anything about maybe 5 to 10 kilometers away. It doesn't matter if that animal is dead, like it's got a bad smelling, but they can able to smell something like that. As we were saying that, when we got them, they were heading south. Now they're heading southwest again. It looks like they're all facing back to where we had kuhuma females. So they might maybe go back that way. Remember the other day I watched them. It was about maybe 4 kilometers where we found them. And behind the waterhole, there was about 10 dagger boys. When we talk about dagger boys, we talk about buffalo. The male buffaloes. So there was behind the water holes. I don't know how do they hear them, I don't know how do they smell them, but when we got them, they were like the nose up, smelling, sniffing. They were all walking in a single file. By the time they were all together, like all six of them, we followed them about 3 to 4 kilometers in a single file. Instead of going different direction, they walked straight in the line. And then they went straight to where the buffalo were. There was about 25 meters behind the water hole, behind the dam. And instead of going down to drink, they didn't do so. They went around in the thicket behind the dam hole, and they managed to get hold of one, and they killed him there at the same time. Because for big guys like this, for buffalo, it takes them about, doesn't take them that long, but because they're so powerful, and the buffalo also very strong, it's not easy a prey. They know that buffalo, it's not an easy prey for them. So I'm sure that buffalo, it was old, and then they managed to take him as soon as possible. And the other nine, they ran. But I know that some other times they protect each other. I don't know if maybe the other nine, they didn't like that bull there. I'm not quite sure about it. Because we have seen many times they don't really run away from these guys. They always stand their ground. And the other day they came to take one of them, but the rest, they said, no, we're not going anywhere. We're going to try to protect or to defend ourselves. And the other eight ran. They left one by himself, but he managed to fight them back. They couldn't even run away. These guys, they had to decide to go somewhere else. because there was no way that they can bring him down. That's why they said, now, this is the strongest guy we have ever seen, maybe, so they decide to surrender and walk away. And the last record I heard about these guys down to the south, I just heard that they killed about 4 hippos, and they've killed about 3 rhinos. That is the last record I heard about these guys. I'm sure they're so capable of taking big games. Thanks. These guys, I know they managed to have, but that's about four months ago. So that's about maybe almost a year. Now I'll get back to that question. I just want to hear them calling. Get closer to those ones.
Yeah, cool. No
problem. Beautiful sound, eh? Okay. See? Maybe they're gonna come back to the boss. What do you think? Looks like he wants to come back to the boss.
You miss a tea here. You have grown a man, you can see.
Yeah.
Down south they call him Saturn.
It's easy to say that. You can easily see. He doesn't want to lie down because he's thinking about killing.
Yeah, they said he's the one that always, when fight develops, he's the one that carries the fight.
Oh, that's beautiful, man.
I see him here walking, Saturn.
But that one there standing is the one, he probably the one who run faster than them. Because he doesn't have any scars on him.
Yeah.
And when it comes to the fighting, I'm sure he's the one who take the lead of running. To come back to that question again about the cubs, as far as I know, we have another pride of females, which is the pride contains about 6 females. The pride's name, it's called a Styx pride. The reason they call them a Styx pride, there was one old female, she used to have like a banded tail. So I don't know what happened to her tail. Probably maybe from the fighting, or she maybe tried to kill something else or do something and their tail broken. And these guys, when they came here, because the Styx pride, they used to spend time in down to the south as well. So these guys, they managed to join them. And Styx pride, they had about 12 cubs. That is, it was about maybe 6 months ago. Since then, I never seen them.
Maybe they decided to go somewhere else, but the cubs I know, they were belongs to these guys. But maybe now they came from them. Maybe the reason we don't see them that often, the females, maybe they're trying to raise them, because they can't bring them up this way, knowing that the Skuhuma females here, if they seize them here, they might kill them all. So maybe they're trying to keep them hidden somewhere else. Maybe when once they're grown up, they will take them on our site again. And down to the west as well, I know there was two females, we used to call them Robson Sprite. Also, they used to have, one of the females, she used to have two cubs. But when I communicate with the other guys from the west, I've been told that one of them has been killed by these guys as well. But I know that the way belongs to them. The cub has been killed by one of these dominant male. These two guys here, the one on the left, that is the first dominant, as I said. The second one is the one with the cat tail at the tip. So the baby, it's been killed by one of these guys. And the other female, Talali, a female, not long ago, we saw her, she had two cubs as well. But the one cub has been killed. We're not 100% sure, but we think maybe it could be a snake or something else, because when we got there, we didn't see any injury. So maybe the baby has been killed by a snake or starvation. We're not 100% sure about it. But I believe in total, these guys so far, they might have about maybe 20 cubs, because some other pride, we don't see them on our site. And the place where we traverse, at this side, I would say so far I have seen only two cubs that are belongs to them. As now they are still trying to get themselves into Kuhuma females, that's why the reason they're coming up more this side to the north. And so if we're lucky enough, if they do manage to join them, maybe it will be nice to see them with Kuhuma pride. We will all see them like regularly in a day. This coalition of males, they've been together from one pride, because as I said, we saw them on 2000, they came into our area. By that time they were still young, they were about maybe 8 months old. They were still young. I saw these young boys, there was about 8 of young boys or 10 of young boys, but all now they're grown up. So the number has gone down. There's only 6 males left. But I found out from the guys from Malamala, I've been told that the pride is still existing down to the south. So I'm sure these guys, every now and then, they go down, because they're trying their best not to stay with their parents. Their parents, they have got their own husbands down to the south. That's why they don't really want to stick around with them. That's why these guys, they have decided to move up to the north and create their own territory, because they don't want to get maybe involved with their fathers or parents, because sometimes they kill each other because of doing that. That's why the males, when they get up to 2.5 to 3 years, that's why where they establish their own territory, because they don't really want to maybe that actually end up fighting, killing each other because of places where they have. So they move away from their parents and do their own thing. So these guys have been together from the first, and I'm sure they're gonna be together until to the last.
Yeah, that's a good question. As according to the tracks, now once we found the tracks, we can manage to see the tracks of an animal. We can also differentiate the tracks. Once we found them, we can also tell. We actually act like African healers. You know, African healers, they use bones to determine the age, your age or your life. So we've been told by the tracks that it looks like they were following them. According to the tracks, the way they were moving, and according to the direction where they were heading to, and to the place where we found the tracks, that is the same place where we found tracks of Kuhuma yesterday in the afternoon. And it looks like they are very interested on following them, because these guys, they are the ones that killed the cubs, I'm sure, because there are some still left there. Because the more they killed all the cubs there, those females, they will come on heat again. They will be very interested to mate, but it will all depending which lions they want to mate with. I'm sure maybe because the reason I said that the first time one of the Kuhuma females, she went down to the south. She is the one who brought this guy up to the north. So she was like very attracted by these guys. It looks like they are beautiful according to myself as well. They are, looks nice. Manyeleti boys also nice. But I think they are looking for the strongest gene. When we talk about the strongest gene, you can easily see these guys, they're all in a good condition, healthy. And also, they're also powerful. So those females, they recognize that once they have the gene. Because the gene, at the end of the day, are the gene that is going to defend them instead of killing or be killed by some other lion. So this, if they do have their own gene like these guys, because, you know, these guys, they stand their ground. I know that we do have more male lions around here, but for these guys, they don't even stand the ground. Even two of these guys, three of these guys, they can manage to chase about 16 animals. Like, that time, the Kuhumas, there was about 16 animals. Two of them, I saw them the other day, very close to Wuyotela Lodge, close to the gate. I was there, I watched them. Two of these guys, they managed to chase all of them away. So which means they have very strong gene, very powerful. So I believe that if they join hands with these females, but I don't think it's going to happen if the Kuhuma females still have that cubs. I'm sure the main thing, yeah, they're still searching for them. So they're trying to see where they went to, and also because of the weather, we've been driving around on the road there. We probably drove over the sand, so they don't know what happened or they don't know where they went to. And this is the place where usually found them, because this is the place where Kuhuma, most of the time, they do their hunt around here. And also this is the place where they mark the territories. Depends how they want. Sometimes they come maybe twice in a week this side. Sometimes they come maybe once in a week. So these guys, they know that, they actually know the boundaries. So they check each and every corner if they've been there. But I'm sure they have checked that yesterday, because when you got the tracks, it looks like there was only three male lions walking in the road. The other one who was like walking on the side of the road, which is, that's how, if they want to attack, they cannot just walk in a single file. They always separate, they scatter it around. If there's anything else, so they can always there for themselves. And also by roaring like that, because now from where we are, the wind, it looks like it blows from the south to the north. The place where we saw Kuhumas, from where we are, it's in the northerly direction. Once they hear them, they will just vanish. I'm sure they're already gone now. They're probably somewhere which I cannot tell. But it looks like the big male here on our left hand side, he probably knows where they went to. Looks like he's very concerned about going or sitting and listening, concentrating to the north here. The other one, he just moved off from the other two. He went down to the south. It looks like he wants to head back to the south again. It looks like the mud need to go into the thick stuff because of the drizzling we have here. We might not enjoy it.
Busy wiping the cover, little bit of moisture.
Thank you. That's a beautiful flowers around you. I don't think they will just lie down today. It looks like they're trying to get somewhere else.
Maybe calling, maybe if you look at the Pumas, maybe one of the female, two of the female, they were showing on a scent that they need to mate.
Yeah.
So it might be calling. It can help if they call. The pumas, they can respond, the female. If not, it will mean that the pumas will have more chance to flee in the right direction.
Yeah, like as when we got there yesterday, according to those young cubs or youngsters, when we got there, you know, the females, they were not wanting to stay with them. Maybe that is the reason. Maybe two or one of them on hit. But they just want to try to leave them somewhere else. Here comes the bigger. Goethe. Okay, a couple of thanks, Andrew. Is Dankonzo Musa from this morning? Thanks, buddy. Keep me updated, please. Yeah, from here we're gonna try to see if we can find Kurula, and we'll keep you updated. I'm gonna try to move a little bit forward. It looks like all of them, they're going down there. Let's go and have a look what they're doing. But the big boss, it looks like he just wanna spend time by himself there. Yeah, these guys, when we talk about the coalition, we talk about the male, the group of males only, without females. So this is the name, they've been named Mapohos because of the strength they have. here in South Africa, we have a very strong security company called Mapohos. Mapoho is a Sotho word for a power. So Mapohos, we have six big male lions. All of them, they're still alive. We thought maybe it could be the big dominant male is dead or somewhere else, but he's back. We can see him here right here. And also when we got here, we saw these guys, they were like listening to some other lions from the south. So all of them, they still survive. Just want to move a little bit forward. Looks like they're doing something there. Just want to see if we can catch them on the other side.
Well, there's a story at Lodolozi that one of Mapoho is killed by buffalo. Is it true?
I'm not quite sure about that. I also heard about it, but it looks like there's something going on because we've got some other nomadic males in the area as well. So some of us, we get ourselves confused, but I don't really think so, but we will work on it.
Yeah, that's true. It's what I also said. You know, the stories of guides sometimes can drive you crazy.
As we can see, they're all just gone into the thickets. They are not lying down. It looks like they're all... I don't know if everybody knows that the lions are carnivores. They don't eat grass, but they do eat grass for some purposes. What they are doing there, as we were talking about what they are doing, it looks like they're all in the mission. They have eaten, according to the way I can see it from here, they have full bellies. So I'm sure most of the time when they want to travel, they cannot able to walk with the full tummy. So what they have to do is to defecate, because they defecate, they cannot just decide themselves. It comes in naturally. It's the... they feel they have in their body. So they have some other plans. If they try to take some other stuff out from their tummy, what they do, they eat grass. But they've got some different grass, which is, you know, the grass, they don't eat it. They only eat it for purposes. They don't eat for food. That's why when they eat grass, they vomit. They bring everything out. So what they're doing there, they're trying to regurgitate what they have eaten. So they're trying to eat some grass. If we're lucky, we will see some of them doing or regurgitating as we are here. I can see all of them that are busy doing, they're all busy eating some grass here. So even if we don't see the rest at the back, we will hear them like regurgitating. For them to eat grass because they've got big canines. I'm sure canines are not made for grass, only for biting or something like a skin or something else. Comes a big boy there. And also the male lions, when they're getting older, they don't a change color, like when I'm talking about the mane. Some of the male lions are dark in color, the manes are dark. So that doesn't mean that animal, that particular animal, it's getting older, just a different genetics. It's like us as a human, we have a blonde, we've got the dark hair, it does the same thing as us. Some, they grow a white hair when they're still young, about 12, 15 years old from there. So that doesn't mean that person is born old. Thanks so much for that question. The Kinky Tal, she's from the pride called Styx Pride. Styx Pride, I haven't seen them for the last 2 months. They're down to the south. The last time we saw them, they had about 12 cubs. The cubs are belongs to this Mapoho males. I haven't seen them for ages, but we will find out about the Kinky Tal. It was a very old female. I'm sure she's already taken her free passport to heaven long time ago. I haven't seen her for a while now.
Yeah, Moses. One of Mapoho male have a kinky tail. One of Mapoho males is having a kinky tail. The question is, one of that kinky tail is here with this former daughter, or he's not here? One of Mapoho tail look like that is broken a little bit, it's kinky, but I don't think it's here. I'm not sure, I haven't checked nicely.
Yeah, okay, no, I got it right. And we haven't got here. The one of Mapoho that it's got a kinky tail now, he's not here today. I thought we were talking about a Styx Pride, the one that it's got a kinky tail. That is the female, but one of the kinky tall male, yeah, he's not here. I'm sure he's probably the ones that are not here. There's two missing here. So he's definitely not in this group today.
They all disappear behind the bushes.
Yeah, it looks like they're still...
they will come out.
Grazing behind the bushes there. They're still eating some grass for regurgitation.
Maybe they'll have a nip here.
Yeah, it looks like it's a little bit drizzling here, so they might just decide to lie down. Yeah, there's two of them that are on the ground lying down. And there's other two here, they're still in the thick stuff here, still walking up and down there. Up and mobile again. But it looks like they're having an indaba there.
Maybe drafting the plan.
Yeah. While they're eating some grass.
But very good news. we heard that Pumas are heading north. Tracks look like going away. I think they will go anyway.
Yeah, it looks like all of them, they're gonna take a nap here. I don't have any good visual from where I am, but it looks like there's another two lying down now, so they might take a nap and maybe try to conserve the energy for the later stage. We can maybe give it another 2 minutes and see what they're gonna do. Then from there we're gonna maybe try something else. Thanks for that question. Like each and every individual animals or individually lions, they can able to recognize each and every lions in the area. So Guhumas, they recognize their own calls as well. They recognize the calls from different animals or different prides of lions. All the lions in the area, they know that. Even these guys, if the two brothers calling, they will able to know that this is from our brothers. Or if there's two different pride of lions calling in the same direction, they will able to differentiate from the call itself. So that's why we just got an update now about a minute ago that Guhuma females, they headed down to the north from here. They're probably about maybe 10 kilometers away from here. So we have another vehicles like trying to follow up and see where they went to, but so far it seems like they're far away from me. They probably heard them calling like early this morning or over the night. And also these guys, if Kuhumas females are calling, they will able to recognize their calls as well. That's why most of the time they don't really kill each other. Because once they recognize each other's calls, they stay away from the properties. And when it comes to the scent, I've got a question yesterday about the scent as well. The scent, it does the same thing as a human. Like us, Rectin will agree with me, we are the soccer players. And also we got like two or three different teams at home. When we off, we always play together. You know, each and every team there, we have like different soccer kits. You know, we all have a different deodorant that we use at home. But sometimes like if you have, if you are married, you know, especially the married couple, sometimes they use the very same deodorant that we use. It does the same thing to animals. Because animals, they don't have something like that. We do buy it from shops or from wherever we buy it from. So I remember the other day, I saw Rexon, he did the same thing exactly what I'm trying to put the point. When we got to the soccer field, before we used to be a caretaker of our soccer kits. So, you know, each and every time after playing in the next day, you have to wash everything. So you put everything nicely, smelling nicely. So you have to give the kids before they play, you have to give to each and every player there. But after that, we take everything together. But that day, because we had less water in the village, so we had to, everybody to take his own jersey back to home. So because by that time, our kid didn't have any numbers, you know. You have to have a number like number 2, number 3 to 12. So, but we didn't have it by that time. So to able to know your kit, you have to smell it. You know, when you play there, you're sweating. So to know it there, you have to take it there and smell it. Each and every person or each and every individually, a person knows that this is belongs to me by the smell. And also, by that time, I know most of them, they've been made with sizes like a small and large, extra large. But, you know, in the field, you have about 16 to 25 people. So they all wear or they all use the same sizes. But to notify yours, you're going to have to smell it. Because when you play there, you end up sweating bad and then, you know, the smell. But everybody knows his own smell. So that's how we used to pick our jerseys from the group. So to an animals, that's the same thing, because these lions, they've been around for many times. Once they found the scent, they know that this is belongs to what we're looking for, and this is belongs to what we're not looking for. So they can able to tell that about the scent. And also these animals, to recognize the scent or rectify the scent, they have got inside the mouth, they've just onto the bottom top lip inside, they have got a Jacobson's organ. So that organ, if the females urinate on the ground, they leave the scent. So these guys, once they come, they will sniff it or they will just lick it, and it goes up to the palate inside the mouth. And so they use that Jacobson's organ to notify everything or all the status of the females. If the female she's on it, these guys, they will able to find it from the urine, wherever they urinated. So they will take it from there, or wherever they send mark, they will take it from there. Because there is a different of if they're urinating, but when they send marking, they don't just bend down on the ground. That is the urinating. But sand marking, they just go against to the branches. And also they need like a high spot. If we look at the tree, if the tree is about 15 meters, they can only manage to spray about maybe a meter or a meter and a half. So that sand is stay a little bit higher. When the wind blows or when the wind bypass there, the wind, it will take everything, because of the smell of the sand, it will evaporate. From where the animal was sand marking, it will maybe evaporate about 5 or 10 kilometers. Also, it depending into the area, like this terrain here, it's nice and open, so it can able to evaporate in a long distances. And sometimes it depends if it's it's too hot, because of the moisture coming from the ground. You will able to see these guys, what they do first, they scrub the ground and urinate on it. So that steam coming from the ground, it takes everything up in the air, and then it evaporates all over in the air. So some other animals, instead of looking at them or see them that these enemies are coming, they smell it from the air, like Kuhuma females. If these guys did the same thing early this morning, when they urinate, especially in the morning, you know, we have two different condition. The ground, sometimes when we feel hot up here, in the ground it's cold, it's different condition. So if they scrub the ground and urinate on it, that steam coming from the ground, it will take everything up in the air, as I was saying this morning, the wind, it blows from the south to the north. So they actually did a lot of help to Kuhuma females. They probably smelled it. That's why they moved up to the north as well. So they're actually moving in a different direction, opposite direction, away from them. So that also, it helps them to chase each other, and also by marking, because these guys, they know the each and every different sand marks. If the sand marks belongs to one of the brothers, that's how they manage to relocate each other, by using the sand. They follow each other by that. So wherever they walk, they leave that sand mark. So it helps the others to find them where they are, but doesn't help the other enemies, because the animals, they don't really need to find them. So it helps the animals to walk away from them. They all still, I can only see one from where I am, still standing in the thicket there. The rest, it looks like they're all lying down, resting.
Yeah. Hiding away from us.
Does anyone have any questions before we try something else? It looks like the, all of them, they're just lying down behind. Can easily see the arrangement of them. You see there's two there and one there and one in front here. So that's how sometimes they sleep. Because they actually need to protect themselves and keep an eye. So maybe there will be one or two on guard, and the rest, they will just take a nap. So from my side, I was thinking about trying something else. We will always come back here this afternoon and see, or we still have enough time, can always come back and see what they're doing. But if for now, it looks like they will just lie down here.
Yeah, this move.
Tata.
Can you see there, the tree? Beautiful. Check on your monitor.
Beautiful, huh?
Yeah. Two.
Bye-bye, lions. See you later. allow us there. Islam, you're on my right hand side.
Go ahead.
Okay, thanks, man. I just left my poker still Lala's same position, Lala's team. Okay, thanks, man. I'll come give you a hand there.
He's looking for almost an angle.
Yeah. Now, I just got an update again. The females, they're quite far from where we are. They haven't found them yet, but they're still following up on the tracks. It looks like they crossed some other places to somewhere else.
Yeah, they stop here, stretch our legs somewhere there.
Now, just want to see these beautiful flowers we have here. So I won't break the other ones because they are so beautiful. So if I break them, I might make them look unbeautiful. So this one in African is called Jacob Straight Up, which means Jacob Straight Up. So you will see some of them are not straight up, some of them are straight up. Beautiful. It looks like a female or a lady with a funny hat, which is beautiful. Yeah, it looks like a lady that is just doing some or modeling. You can call it like that. Beautiful flowers. Nice smell there. I love it. And this one on my left here, it's got also a beautiful yellow flowers at the top here. It's called a black jack. This is called Morocco. Local people, they eat it a lot in summertime. One of my sister yesterday, when I got back, I had some morocco as well. Morocco means vegetable. It's easy to prepare it. What you have to do is just to boil water. And just get a couple branches of them. Or leaves. You just hoe it in or put it in. Just cook it. You just add some salt. It's very nice. It tastes like a spinach we have. But I prefer this one, because you can only get it in the bush. You don't have to buy it, you just get it for free. It's beautiful.
Cool. Smells good, eh? The blackjack.
Oh, it's beautiful. The Morocco. See the beautiful flowers on the left there? That actually it falls under hibiscus family. Most of the plants here, we don't have any English name for it. Because some plants here are not indigenous. They've been brought down here by the farmers. A long time ago, when there was no fences here, people, they used to walk across here with the horses. Some of the plants, like, they used to feed them with horses. Because the horses, they used to feed, they used to browse or they graze around there, so wherever they were, they were defecating, so they left everything around here. So some of them are not indigenous. So we haven't got an English name for it. So thanks everyone, we'll take a short break. We'll get back as soon as possible.
The waterhole cameras were down, actually still down. We can't switch back to the waterhole, so I've asked Rectan to put the camera on something nice, like this flower. So the camera will stay with them. Rectan and Moses will quickly stretch their legs for a little while, and then as soon as they're ready, in maybe between 5 and 10 minutes, we will continue with the game drive.
Back everybody, we're gonna proceed looking for some different animals.
It's raining Easter, we're not gonna go out there.
Yeah. Maybe try this road?
Yeah, we can try that one. I can see heavy rain coming there.
And see if we can find the ruler taxi.
She might be more east where it's raining. Not sure when we get to the high ground.
very interesting what we're looking at here on the right-hand side. We've got a termite mound. A termite mound, the trees that you see on top of the termite mound, and also the ground that you see over there, this soil type, it's been brought out by the termites. So the termites we've got two different types of termites. We've got a wood termites that feed on the dead materials, like dead wood. And we also have got like a regular termites. They also have, they've got big head, brown in color. They've got two pincers, small body. They've got about six legs. So what they do, the termites, the regular termites, they don't feed on grass. So what they do is they find like a place, like a place there, like a flat area. So what they do is they drill into the ground. Most of the time here, our water level, also depending on the area, our water level, it can get up to 35 meter deep. Or some places it's about 60 meters deep until you hit the water level underground. And the termites here, what they do, they drill into the ground. We have mostly, they live in a very big group, about maybe 800 to 1,000 or 1,005. It depends how they feel like to. We have a queen. A queen, her job is to produce babies. So she once they made a place where the queen will stay, so she will stay there. Her job is to lay some eggs. So they will be living inside the ground. The ground that you see there, what they do, like every day when they're digging, they take all the ground up. That's why they're building this big mound here. It's not been created by God outside, like what you see there. It's been created by the termite. So they take the soil from underground and put it outside here. As we drive around, I'll show you the difference between this type of soil and the soil we have. Like you can easily see here on back to the road, yeah. And also what they do is, as they're living together as a team, if you look around, the ground it is very rich. So the birds and the animals, some birds they feed on fruits, animals also, we have a lot of grazers here, like impalas, like rhinos as well, does the same thing. So this kind of ground here is so rich, and when it rains, it produces like a different species of grass, a different species of trees. Like as you see, we've got I don't know how many species that I can see, maybe about 5 to 6 different species of plants that I can see. So the termites, what they do is like we inside there, we've got two types as well in the same type of termites. We've got soldiers. The soldiers, they are the ones that they have a brown head. They've got two pincers. So that pincers, they use it for biting or defending themselves. So we've got the workers. The workers, their job is to build a mound. The soldiers, they don't build, because the pincers they have, it's not been made for a building. It's for defending. So the soldiers, while the workers are still working, they will come out from the ground and stay on to the entries there and see if there's any danger. They have got a lot of enemies, which is, we've got an animal, it's called the aardvark, which is, it looks like a warthog we saw yesterday. It's got a very long pointed nose. So that nose, it's actually it uses it for digging, and it's got a very very long toes as well. So that toes there, they actually use it for digging as well. So what they do, once they found the big mound like that, they look at it and see if that mound is still active. Because the termite, what they do is when in the night time is where they're more active, because they know that most of the birds, they're not active that time. Most of the nocturnal birds here we have, they don't feed on them. So the birds that you see like during the day, like a yellow-billed hornbill, we call them a flying bananas. They feed on them. We've got many different species of birds that they feed on termites. So those are the one, if you see the trees growing on top of the termites, those are the one that when they feed on other different trees, they come and sit on top here while they're busy feeding on termites. They defecate on top. So that seed, it actually goes back to the ground and germinate and becomes a tree again, or becomes a grass from there. So that when we come back to the termites again, the termites, as they're living together, the termites, they can manage to destroy the very big land for grazing. So what they do, you see here, just on the side of the termites, on the side of the termites towards us, there's the bare patches. What you see there, that doesn't mean the grass, it doesn't grow. It does grow there, but because the animals, they know this is a rich area for the grass to grow. Like every now and then, if it rains, if we have a drizzling, or if we have a rain about 15 milliliter a day, the grass, it will grow. So the animals, they're there, they keep on checking every single day. You see, if you look carefully more to the right, there's a lot of tall grasses there. Tall plants. If you look on the left as well, there's hibiscus there, and there's a lot of grass, but animals that don't really eat it. They only eat close to the termite mound because they don't need that grass. There are also animals that they've got a preference of food they eat. They prefer very good grass. And when you come back again to the termites, they live inside. They have built many tunnels inside. They have got storerooms inside. They've got kitchen when they cook. They've got bedrooms where they sleep. So as I said, we've got soldiers. They are the one protecting the workers. They're more active at night, or even today, as we drive, I'll try to find like a very active termite. So you will see them. I will be able to show you the difference in between. So what they do is the termite, the workers, they come out and start collecting the grass and take the grass around the mound and put it back again into the holes. So they... Yeah, the aardvark, they are definitely nocturnal animals, but they're more active late at night. By that time, sometimes we already return back to the lodge. But even us, we don't really see them quite often here. If I'm not mistaken, last year I only see aardvark once. So they're more active at night time. So they are definitely a nocturnal animal, but they're more active like late at night. And the places where they live in a very, very, very thick stuff.
Hello everyone, Space speaking at the final control. So I think the battery is flat at the moment, so I'm gonna close everything this side. For myself, Spiwe here at FCC, and presenter was Moses and cameraman was Rexin. So stay tuned for the next episode we walk. And as you see now, you see FCC, there is no Garu water hole, it's lost the picture at the moment, so we're gonna enjoy FCC. Simon is behind me, he's waving hands, so we're gonna enjoy FCC at the moment. Pete's still down to the lodge to see what's going on about the camera, so as soon as everything will be sorted out, we'll be at Garu. Enjoy with us at the moment. Cheers. Thanks, Mike, for asking. I'm not sure about that, but I think Rexine is going to come back here and maybe he know exactly what's going on. So if there is no work, I will keep updating you. But at the moment, no one let me anything know. So stay tuned.